Welcome to another episode of Grade Pending, you know, the show where we talk about media, movies, TV shows, all that stuff, and give our grade, our review on it. You know, we have our unique grading system, Awesome, which is the top of the top, the cream of the crop, the best of the best. We got Dope, which is very good, not perfect, not the bestest, but hey, it's a good show, good piece of entertainment. We got Meh, which basically is all right, or watched it once, not trying to watch it no more. And then we got Straight Trash, with I'm never watching it again. It was hot garbage. Get this out of my face. Why did I spend money on this? However you feel about it. All right.
And to talk about it, we got to talk about it. So there will be spoilers. If you have not seen it, you know, watch, come back, talk to us. And what are we talking about today? First off, we're going to talk about the movie, the new MCU Marvel movie, The Marvels. We're going to talk about that right now. Like I said, there will be spoilers. So let's start with our individual grades.
For The Marvels, honestly, I think it was actually a really good movie. Excuse the background noise. This is the streets of New York and stuff. Maybe some Avenger-type stuff going on down here. I don't know. Because clearly when people have actual damage on human worlds, shit goes to hell. Just ask Kamala's parents' house. Because that was a hell of a fight scene where everybody started fighting and breaking up the whole house and stuff. But I think it was great how they tagged into one another and kind of found out how each one's power entangled. Shout out to Will and Jada. I think it was a really good movie. The idea that you had X-Men tying at the end of it, you know, going to another universe, you know, that kind of put things a little bit over the top. But I think it was a well-written, I think it was a well-performed movie. Kamala Khan is a budding star. I'm a big fan of, Tiana Paris, shout out to my girl Folstein, who had no call sign, didn't want to have a call sign, didn't want to have no superhero name, just Captain Rambo. But, Brie Larson, the annihilator, the gentrifier that she was, stealing people's resources. I think it was cool. You know, it had heart. You know, it gave the Kree reason to kind of be more of a dick than what they usually were anyway. Stealing resources, which is also justification. Anyway, but I'm gonna overall say awesome, dope. I teed a title with this one because I kind of want to give it awesome, but I'm gonna give it a high dope though. I really enjoyed it. I feel it was a really good, fun movie. Shout out to fangirl Kamala. So I'm gonna give it a high dope on that one. It was a really good story.
As far as Marvels, right? I give Marvels we gotta give Marvels a dope, all right? Because I'm glad I saw it. I saw Loki on Thursday, and I actually went to go see the Marvels on Friday. And with the comedic flair that it had, some people were saying that was too much, but I thought it was well balanced, especially because if you think about Captain Marvel's solo movie, a lot of people were complaining about the dryness of the character. So I thought that Kamala and Captain Rambo, Monica Rambo, gave it a nice balance. And look, man, people can say what they want. Look at the numbers, like all these stat babies out of nowhere talking about the box office, but you got to go see the movie for yourself. I believe I told Paul earlier the reason why the movie probably didn't do well box office numbers is because, unfortunately, I don't want to get into other topics, but we know that the support with all female cast doing anything is not anywhere near when men do it, and I'll leave it there. Also, if you have the casual Marvel fans that are men, they probably didn't go because of all female cast, and maybe a lot of parents didn't bring their daughters to that movie like they brought them to Barbie, And Barbie had a completely different message from what we saw in the Marvels. The end credits, I thought that was amazing. How they just pretty much they recon a lot of movies with that end credit, where you're able to see, spoiler alert, obviously, where you're able to see Beast and then Binary at the end credit, as we now know that there is a universe where the X-Men, of course, exists with Charles Xavier, Beast, and others being alive. So I thought that was great. I'm interested to see what happens with Monica, see how She gets over the emotional trauma and hurt from her mom passing while she was blip. But also, the movie, why I didn't give the movie a dope was because the element it was missing was that conversation that she should have had with Captain Marvel. I mean, they both had someone that they love that passed away, and they just didn't talk about it. And obviously, in the movie, they're going through dreams and visions, and you see that Captain Marvel did come back, even though Monica said she never came back. And that was something that I think the movie missed. They missed the opportunity to dive into that, to actually have them come together and solve that. I thought that could have been a nice emotional pull, so to get the audience brought into the story even more. But overall, man, it was good. And look, some people might have found it corny, but I love when they went to the planet and the language that they spoke was song. So, you know, I ain't gonna sing on here. I'm gonna save your ears. But everything they spoke about, they had to sing. And then she spoke regular English, and the guy was able to sing. And she's like, yeah, he's bilingual. So I thought that was a nice comedic tone as well. But overall, I'll give it a dope.
So I got to see Marvels on Saturday. I showed in IMAX, and I was shocked that the IMAX theater was completely empty. Like, there was seats available like crazy. So that had me a little worried when I went in to see it, I'm not gonna lie. But I kept my expectations, you know, at the ground level. For me, I love the way it started. It backtracked. If you hadn't seen Ms. Marvel, it gave you that filler gap of how it ended and to where it catches up to the Marvels. For me, I think the movie was all around, I would say, dope. It wasn't a typical Marvel movie. It had comedy. It had energy. Like, it was nonstop through the entire movie, where they jumped from one scene to the next, and they kept that flow going. I love the comedic relief of her family. I think that was a great touch, because usually we see Marvel touch on families and not really go back to them. So it was good to see them transition through the entire movie that we got to see her family. For me, Samuel Jackson was very different. You know, we got to see him curse in this one and really let loose. Brie Larson, I think there's still a lot of work to be done with her as a character in general. She does come across real stiff, real stale. But the other two leading ladies, I think, carry the hell of that movie. I think the young woman that plays Miss Marvel, I think Marvel has found a star to pass the torch to. You know, we've seen a lot of Tom Holland the last, what, 6-7 movies. So I think this might be the leading lady they're looking for to lead Marvel. And for me, all in all, I'm going to give it a dope from beginning to end. It had action. It had comedy. It was funny. You know, it wasn't a major shocker movie. Like, we knew where it was leading up to. We knew what was going to happen. The villain, again, no one's really going to remember her as a villain. I think she was just, you know, you need a villain, obviously. So she was just a filler villain, nothing to build upon. But all in all, I'm going to give it a dope.
So my voice is messed up. Feige got me, bro. He knew what was coming, and he took me out. So I just got three words. Black girl magic. That's all I got to say about this. Nah. Yeah, this movie was it was a movie. It was about an hour and 45 minutes. It was butchered by the editors. Overall, I'm a big fan of Kamala Khan and Ms. Marvel. Brie Larson as Captain Marvel and Kamala as Ms. Marvel. And I got no problem with Photon. She's thick. But yeah, as a film, did it really work? Now did it, boys? Box office aside, whatever. It bombs. The worst Marvel movie of all time. Whatever. These things happen. As a movie, you know, it was okay. It was funny stuff was funny sometimes. The story wasn't really there. The villain was non-existent. It's ultimately not memorable at all. The last 5 minutes of like, I'm little Nick Fury, let's get the young Avengers. No, you're not, because that's not, who's gonna go see that? No one. Based on this performance, they have to course correct. The X-Men stuff at the end, the dangling the keys. Keep watching. That didn't work. It leaked beforehand, but even if it hadn't, it's not gonna work. It's not. It's the MCU is dead, boys and girls. Feige can try to take my voice out, but the MCU is dead. This movie, that being said, all that mixed words aside, it was better than Wakanda Forever. Yeah, I was thinking about how does this compare to the other movies? It was much more rewatchable than Wakanda Forever. So there's that. That being said, this is a high meh. I can't give it the dope because it's not really a movie. It's just a bunch of scenes put together. Yeah, high meh for sure. And I can't wait to discuss.
The Marvels. I enjoyed it. I saw a lot of reviews prior, thanks to Otto spamming our group chat with a lot of Marvel hate, which is why I'm glad he lost his voice. Because we could barely hear what he said. What I took from what he said was that he loved the movie. It was the greatest movie of all time. If you remember, Otto said he had a pet. The pet's name is Marvel. So, Otto was looking forward to this movie. He's lying. He said otherwise. But my perspective is the movie was watchable. It was decent. It was enjoyable. Definitely felt like a lot of scenes were missing that may have added better context or more substance to the story. I don't know why they cut it to be so low, just to be so short. Maybe those other scenes they felt were, slowing the pace of it, but I think it would have benefited because the movie is very fast-paced, very chopped from scene to scene to scene to scene to scene. However, I did enjoy it. I did feel the Fury saying Black Girl Magic was awkward, especially how it just came out. However, I was worried about the all musical planet thing. I think they cut that right where it needed to be cut. As soon as we found out that he was bilingual, they never went back to it again. I think that was good. Unlike those screaming goats that kept coming back, they didn't come back to that. So I think that was smart on their behalf to not have that run on for too long. The cats also could have been a very corny moment. It didn't come off as corny. However, I was surprised that they even chose that route. It didn't come off as corny, but it was like it didn't need to be needed. But it did kind of work. It didn't come off as corny. It just was like a weird thought. And even when they crash landed, they were crashing from space and just landed on Earth right next to Statue of Liberty with no problems, no issues. I didn't get that. With that being said, like I said, I did enjoy the movie. I do look forward to what's next. Spoilers as always. The scene when Kamala is recruiting Hawkeye, the female Hawkeye, Haley Stanfield. And I think that was awesome because the Kamala Khan is like every one of us, if we were teenagers who looked up to these heroes, then got to work with these heroes, and she's making her own team. It just made sense because, again, from a different perspective, Fury was doing it for protection, and she's doing it from, I got this tablet, and I got these others like me, and now I was part of a team, now I can make a team that's relatable to me. Is they're all teenagers or whatever, then, or young adults, so to speak. But I thought that worked. The mid-credit scene, I thought it was okay. It does. I've seen a lot of people look forward to it online and look forward to what's to come. I feel like it opens up a lot of possibilities and it connects to what everyone's been complaining about, that there was no connection to the multiversal type storyline that they were building. And I feel like we got that more so than ever now, which I felt we already had, but now I think it's even more so now, because now we're going to get the other side of a multiverse that may, connect to what we're dealing with in our, whether it's 19999 or 616 or whatever universe they want to continue to be. So I'm torn. Maybe if I watch it again, I would go low dope. I'm still going to go high meh, which is still good. It's passable. It's about the average of where it's at. Going a high meh. Maybe on the second watch, I might go up or I might go down. But right now, one watch, I enjoyed it still, but it's not the best. Which is okay, though. They can't all be home runs.
So So since we both gave it the same score, do you also agree that it's better than Wakanda Forever?
No, I do not agree. It's because if you look at my Wakanda Forever review, I gave a higher grade for Wakanda Forever. Now, yeah, I gave
Wakanda Forever a higher grade as well because it's an actual film.
It's a better movie.
It's a better made film, but okay. this is better more watchable.
Well, this is more watchable. I think Wakanda Forever is not as watchable because of the context. It's a more emotional movie. So yes, more fun movies are more rewatchable. Emotional movies is something you don't want to continuously relive over and over and over. That's why I feel it's a more rewatchable movie.
Yeah. The emotion being that it's trash.
No, that's not the emotion. No, the emotion is the dealing with grief and family and loss and things like that. This one, they could have had some more emotion in it, but I feel like they got rid of that. Where, like Gene said, there was missed opportunities where they had that memory flashback. They should have, that a conversation should have came from that. It should have been more of a discussion. And they also had an opportunity where Kamala meeting Captain Marvel could have had a moment of, damn, you're not who I thought you was. And you know, that old saying, be careful if you meet your heroes. They missed an opportunity with her having a little bit of, oh damn, you're not the hero I thought you was. Or especially when they left the planet and she was like, yeah, we got to save everybody. She's like, no, we can only save who we can. That should have been a moment of her teaching her how to be a hero, or hey, sometimes we got to make the tough decision. Like, no conversation came from those decisions that she made to even teach her how to be a hero, or say, hey, you might look at me as a, you know, bad person for letting people die, but we have to save who we can. We got to save the few to help, you know, move on. And you know, something should have more came from it. I think it was a missed opportunity. I think that's where you know, they needed a little bit of depth and conversation or more emotion to the movie. I think that's what would have gotten a better grade. So.
What was your theater turnout?
We won't talk about this. You see the numbers. You see the numbers.
I'm curious.
You saw the numbers.
Who told us what he had?
It was not sold out. It was packed. It was a lot of people when I went. I went the 6 o'clock show Thursday, the Dolby Theater, it was packed. It wasn't sold out though. It wasn't sold out, but the general consensus, people did enjoy it. People left and were, you know, happy with it. From what I heard, you know, just hearing chatter as they were walking out, I didn't hear people, oh, this was horrible. I didn't hear that. But like I said, it wasn't a full sold out theater. And even going into it, you know, it wasn't a line. Concession didn't have a line. Like it was a sad sight for a Marvel movie. But again, the money that it did make is great for any other franchises. You know what I'm saying?
Nah, not with what it cost. Sorry about
that. Well, agreed. But still, it can make in 4 weeks. It can make its money back. You know what I'm saying? Hopefully, word of mouth.
My friend, the Beyonce movie comes out. Are you crazy? This is not making another dollar. Beyonce comes.
Is she gonna do Taylor Swift numbers? I don't know. She gonna do Taylor Swift?
No, she's gonna beat Taylor Swift because
Taylor Magic. But Taylor's partnered with the NFL. You know, Travis Kelce. Like, I don't know if Beyonce, Jay-Z. You know, Jay-Z's Jay-Z, but he ain't put out nothing in a while, so he can't compete with that. You know, what's up, Lou? What you got? Talk to me.
For me, I think I go with dope because it is what it is, right? We mm-hmm. all knew it was going to be what it is. Coming off the numbers that Ms. Marvel did on her own, Captain Marvel did on her own, like what were we really going to expect from pairing Captain Marvel with two characters that we only seen on Disney Plus? You know what I'm saying? For where they landed on, especially holiday weekend, it was a Veterans Day, like. That's not really a bringing people out to the movies kind of holiday. I think this shined a light on, like, hey, look what we did with Disney Plus shows. Look how they can impact movies. And to see that two brand new movie stars in the Marvel world can come and dominate, like, and own the screen the way they did, you can instantly tell there was a chemistry between the three ladies. And that was dope to see. Because usually you have that, you know, they were off key because they were switching powers. 10 minutes into it, it was like, don't use your power when you figure this out. It mm-hmm. wasn't like putting the Avengers together and they figured out the last 5 minutes, mm-hmm. you know, of the fight. So I love the fact that we took two lesser-known characters that were housed in Disney Plus, shows that came out over a year ago, you know, during the pandemic, and they still managed to put a good enough product out. I'm not saying it was going to be earth-shattering and here comes the next group of a super team. I think we've been building to the Young Avengers since Infinity War, you know, when we had Spider-Man going to outer space, and then we saw, you know, Ant-Man 3 with his daughter, Love and Thunder with his daughter. You know, we all these builds to younger cast. I think Marvel's trying to find who to hand it off to. I think Kamala Khan is the one that eventually is going to get the reins and take the next wave of Avengers on a trip. So that's why I give it a dope. I know Otto's like, Marvel's dead, but I think we need that refresh. You know, we just can't go into, okay, here's the X-Men. Like, we need that bridge. You know, we need that passing of the torch. And I think the Young Avengers can do that because you can have them now, bridge them to the X-Men, let the X-Men carry us for a while, and then come back full circle. Like, okay, we've seen these Avengers grow up. Now watch them do their thing. So that's what I think that Marvel's plan is. Be the bridge and then come back to the Young Avengers later on down the road.
I think the biggest issue for the MCU has been pandemic.
The women.
Shut up. Pandemic. the strike. Like, there's been there's been a lot of constant things to screw up production, reshuffle.
Oh, also the horrible movies.
But they haven't been horrible. So listen.
They have.
I looked it up. Out of 45 projects, movies and Disney Plus shows, only three have not been fresh on Rotten Tomato. Only three out of 45.
Yeah, the last three. Yeah,
no, last not three. Even the last
it's
three.
Over,
no,
Johnny, it's over.
The Marvels is fresh. It's not rotten. I'm sorry. You can fight it all you want. That's you said
you just gave it a rotten. So shut up.
No, I didn't. It's fresh. Six or better is fresh. Six or better is fresh. It's fresh.
Ladies and gentlemen of the court, you see this man grasping at straws.
I'm not. This is
hard out there. It's hard out there.
So this
that's
is
why I implore all of you to join me in the Blue Beetle Battalion. Blue Beetle was way better.
It wasn't.
Captain Marvel.
The family was handled better. Kamala's family was handled better than Blue Beetle's family was. They didn't have to.
They didn't have a grandma. Get out of here, bro.
Yes. Please. And grandma shooting the big machine gun.
Right, right.
We call that cinema.
Get away from that. Which is dope.
Blue Beetle was
cool. See grandma and Blue Beetle. Crazy.
I was good on that. I enjoyed the family dynamic of it being an introduction, so to speak, because again, most people did not watch Ms. Marvel. So introducing her family dynamic and all that, it made sense. Them being a part of it. It made sense, and they were entertaining still.
Is there a reason that Sam Jackson was completely different than the Nick Fury from the show that
so
they wouldn't even
back
mention?
To my point, this was actually supposed to come out before Secret Invasion. So timeline-wise, we don't know if this is before or after. Again, that's been a big issue for the MCU project. A lot of them are getting shuffled around and moved around due to filming availability, and that's why they did it. That's why, you know, They pushed Secret Invasion out because they filmed a lot of it in secluded areas and stuff during the pandemic and stuff. So they had a lot of footage filmed, and it also was a downside of it because there was scenes where they rushed in the president to the hospital and there's a doctor and one nurse in the whole building. It's like where there's no people in this hospital. So it dealing with that is part of the issue. So a lot of movies have got shuffled around, a lot of shows have got shuffled around. So I can't even say, oh, he should have been this way because that movie just had. I don't know because we don't know when it takes place, and
agreed. And we won't find out till they put it on Disney Plus,
right? Or if somebody does the whole the timeline goes like this, and then we'll say, okay, well then that doesn't make sense. But for now, I don't know. And people have their theories of when things take place. But until Feige or somebody, you know, says, okay, this was remember they had, you know, Fury's big week, and until they say when things are happening. I don't know. This could have been before. It could have been after. I don't know. But the movie was supposed to come out before Secret Invasion on the original timeline, on the original release schedule. So I can't hold that again. Now, granted, to your point, Fury was still weird. It was like, this is not Fury that we've seen for years.
But this, you know what I'm saying, he'd been in space for a minute. So it might be Fury hanging around a bunch of, you know, Skrulls and astronauts. He's loosened up a little bit. We've seen him at the end of Spider-Man. He was chilling on a fake beach and stuff. This might be a, you know what I'm saying? I don't know. You know what I'm saying? But like I said, the Black Girl Magic line was awkward. But other than that, he was just the glue, basically, to it all. That's how I felt. He was the glue.
He was the only man in the movie.
Well, and come no, on, dad and brother.
No, please. I don't count the they them prince she was married to in space. So it was literally just Fury. You know what I mean? Like, all right.
Kamala's dad, Kamala's brother, the black astronaut, Darbin's sidekick. It was men in here. All right. It was men in here. It was a couple of guys. So he had a few. So yes. Anything.
So as Lou was mentioning it, and I giggled. It's a lot of female Young Avengers. What are we doing? What's going on?
Well, I mean, we're gonna get.
We got Spider-Man.
What, bro? No, Spidey's not gonna be in the Young Avengers.
Yeah, I'm saying no.
The rumor is we're gonna get Wiccan.
Right.
Iron Lad's gonna show up, which is another variant of Kang. So there will be some guys in there. There'll be some guys in there. Oh, Hulk's son is going to be there.
Right, we saw him.
So there's going to be some guys.
Your face said it all. Okay, but hey, we'll see. This movie's totally going to happen.
He's putting it. But wait, you love the women. You loved Hawkeye. You loved
them. I do. That's why it's so hard for me, because I want to shit on this, but I love the women. I love the singing. I had no problem with the singing and dancing, but I'm a fucking weirdo. The average guys that didn't go see it, you know.
We don't care about we care about you. Be honest. What do you think about it?
I think the musical planet should have been a longer sequence, if you're asking.
No, I was happy it was cut. I was happy it didn't drag on. I thought that was funny seeing
The cat stuff with the alien. Like, none of that shit made sense. It was fun. Yeah.
Right.
It was entertaining.
Right.
The crowd, my audience was enjoying it.
I love seeing
silly.
I love seeing, you know, Miss Marvel like enjoying the singing, like, you know.
Yeah.
Photon was like, what?
And Photon, no,
and she's like, I like this. So again, the dynamic worked. I like the dynamic.
Chemistry. The chemistry was there. The chemistry. Sure.
Yeah, I thought it worked.
Only they had a plot or a villain. Oh man, it would have been crazy.
Had a plot. I think the stuff that was cut out affected the plot, but
cut the shit out of the movie.
Her reasoning, she had a reason for doing what she was doing. We just didn't get enough substance to it. Like, it was like, who are you again? And that's where it kind of fumbled. And she needed a Disney Plus show. A Disney Plus show to fill in some blanks.
My question, and I know Gene was like, oh, these number Nazis, whatever. The drop-off for next week, what do we think it's going to be? Now, I broke records as the worst Marvel movie of all time, but second week, do you think it can drop? Or since it made no money, it can't really drop much lower, right? Like, where do you think it's going to...
I think the word of mouth is going to... We'll see if... Because it's getting good fan reviews. And the critic reviews...
Where is it getting good fan reviews?
It's 85% on Rotten Tomatoes.
You know the shit.
I talked to people that said they liked it. We all liked it. Nobody said it was trash. Everyone here gave it a good review. So if you watch our...
Well, we haven't heard from John yet.
John is MIA. So as far as this show, everyone likes it. Go see the movie this weekend, please.
It was way better than Thor The Dark World.
Absolutely. Way better than Thor. Way better than Eternals. Way better than Wakanda Forever. Three Thors. Way better than the... Every
Wakanda Forever.
No. Way better than all the Ant-Mans, way better than Eternals, better than Doctor Strange 2.
If you look at Phase 5.
We're in Phase 5.
Phase 5, right? Yeah. So how many pieces of Phase 5 do we got? Loki, what else? This, what else?
It's Quantumania. Ant-Man.
So this is better than Quantumania for sure. I don't know.
Yeah.
So, I mean...
It's ending of Phase 5. And once again, we have a big gap now, because next year we're only going to get one movie. So again, these you know, pandemics of sorts keep affecting the franchise. Now we're only get one movie next year. They were trying to get 3-4 movies. That's not happening. So now we're only getting Deadpool next year,
It's going to be a gap. We're going to get Echo. We're going to get
Agatha, Echo,
whatever the name of her show is now. Can they keep changing the name?
Changing that shit.
But we're at least getting those two shows and one movie next year. So, again, the strike and
so two more female-led things, what are you saying?
Well, I don't know. Echo looked like it was Kingpin led.
It's over, baby.
Echo looked like. Tell me the Echo trailer didn't look good.
What's the name of the show?
Echo.
What's her sex? But, it's over, baby.
Well, she's Native. We don't want to assume her pronouns. Okay, we let her tell us in the show if she wants to. You know, but the trailer was very Kingpin heavy, so we might get a lot of Kingpin in there.
They're definitely trying to sell you. I'll give you that much. They're definitely trying to sell you.
It was a good trailer. It was a good trailer. I'm looking forward. I wasn't looking forward to it before. The trailer dropped. I'm looking forward to it now. So I think it's going to be good. But if you've seen it, let us know what you think. Comment below. You know, go see it. You know, I think everyone should go see it. Don't let the critics sway you, except for us.
I have another real quick thing.
Okay, go ahead.
Lou, did you pay to see this?
Yes.
You paid how much? 20 bucks?
IMAX. Well, it was the IMAX movie.
Yeah, IMAX.
Yeah, well, IMAX had like a $2 promo. I don't know if you got the promo or not.
No.
So, okay, so that's like, what, 25 bucks, right, roughly?
Yeah, right, if, roughly.
Okay. And you still feel you got your money's worth?
Yes, absolutely.
Because that's another thing, Paul. You and I, you know, we got the passes, so we don't really look at movies the same way. Because I looked at it, I was like, I was entertained for 2 hours. It was a little silly, sure, but like, this cost me nothing. Because I saw 4 other movies this month, so like, who cares? But then I was like, yo, what if I paid $25 for this? I'd be so angry. But would I? I don't know. It sounds like Lou still thinks it's worth it.
I don't think I would have been mad at it. But if you want to see it on the Tuesdays, Follow Tuesdays or something, you know, why not? But I think
I think it's definitely worth watching, boys and girls, on the big screen. If you get a discount, you know, see it.
Go see
it. I don't know about $25. $25 is a little steep.
Go see it. Let us know what you think. You know, share your thoughts below, you know, and we'll be back to talk about Loki season 2. And we're back. You know, right now we're going to talk about Loki season 2. Once again, spoiler warning for anyone that has not watched it yet, but to talk about it, we have to talk about it. So if you have not seen it yet, or you're still catching up on episodes, finish that off first and then come on back and watch us, because we're going to talk all about it and, you know, it's and its gloriousness. All right, but first off, let's give it our individual reviews first.
Definitely want to talk about Loki season 2. I mean, I don't know which better way you could write a story in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. I watched the season over and over again. The way that they pretty much did the entire series in the Ouroboros from episode 1 to episode 6 of season 2 and giving Loki his glorious purpose, as they said, I thought it was fantastic. I think that it opens up the doors for many possibilities. There's a lot of comic book stories that could come from that, as Loki does have an arc where he becomes the god of stories, which we pretty much saw at the end of episode 6. So for me, however, I am interested to see what happens to Renslayer. You know what they do with her, being that she was in front of Elias, and then also obviously depending on what goes on with Jonathan Majors and his personal life, that could have a huge bearing on the future of Marvel movies and shows. But if anything, worst case scenario, if the unfortunate thing happens, you can just recast them. But overall, I think that they gave Loki a great story, a redemption story with purpose, and you know, I will shed a little thug tear. I'm giving Loki an awesome.
Loki season 2, overall. I think Loki is the best series that they got on Disney Plus in terms of the Marvel shows. Season 2 was no different. It kind of sucks that it kind of, you know, I don't know what's going on with John Prometheus's case. Honestly, you know, I'll leave my comments to that alone, you know, barring whatever going on, you know, legally. But it kind of sucks that it kind of reduced Kang's role, or for everything to kind of tie into one another, kind of reducing Kang's role at the moment right now does kind of suck. So I don't know really how things are going to lead into Kang Dynasty or Secret Wars itself. Who knows? Things can also have a different spin to it. But just in terms of the show itself, it's the best show they got on Disney. You know, and you know, Loki at the end, you know, becoming the god of the world and having the world tree, which looks like Norse mythology. And if you follow Norse mythology, you know, like these all symbols kind of tie and look familiar and feel familiar. Hell, if you even don't even do that and you play God of War, you can kind of see a world tree like that, you know, and see, you know, nine realms and stuff like that. And even the use of the word realm at the end when they, you know, when they said, you know, 616 adjacent realm. So, you know, it's pretty cool that they have, you know, that they're kind of bigging up Loki. And yes, he's had a big 14-year career with Marvel. Didn't realize it's been that long. But it's cool that Tom, you know, damn near saving Marvel Studios by himself. well, WandaVision was dope too. So, you know, but Loki, in terms of the season, it was a great performance. The time slipping and understanding how to understand his life, and gave Loki, you know, in terms of the first and the last episode, glorious purpose. You know, it was a great loop to see, you know, where he came from to where he's at now. Because before, he didn't give a shit about anything about himself, and then he became a person who cared. And it's kind of a benevolent God at this point. We'll see how things go later on, but I'm definitely going to give Loki an awesome. Like I said, it's one of the best shows that runs, and great story, great arc.
All righty, boys and girls, Loki season 2. So before I get into my review of Loki season 2, I thought Loki season 1 was good until the end, when it didn't have an end, because it was last minute. They were like, oh, let's just make it a to be continued. And that's why I ranked it so low. Like, after I finished season 2, I went back and watched where I ranked season 1 when we did our phase 4 review. I had Loki at like number 10. Now that they gave it a completely new creative team and actually finished the story, so much better. I have nothing but good things to say about season 2, which is crazy. Now, boys and girls, to be fair, the only way they were able to pull off a good season is by going to our one true savior, Tom Cruise, and a little known film, Live, Die, Repeat, aka Edge of Tomorrow, where Tom Cruise had to keep repeating things over and over and over again to get it right. And they stole it completely for the finale of Loki season 2. And that's why it was so good, baby. You go with Tommy. That's all you really need. They stole my boy from Multiverse, the good Multiverse movie that came out last year. Trust me, I was going in not wanting to watch this, like hate watching it. But I mean, when the ingredients are there, the cinematography was better. The score was the best score Marvel's ever done, probably 10 out of 10. Like, you close your eyes, just listen to the final episodes, just the score, and but transcend it. The Kang problem and how, like, they put themselves in a situation where they can, if they want to, never mention Jonathan ever again and bring in. I know, Paul, I know you've been talking about how much you want The Rock to replace him. This might actually happen. So, nah, it's an awesome. Season 2 of Loki is an awesome. A rare awesome that I really pray that they don't fuck up, because this is a perfect ending for Loki as a character. His arc is better than his brother's. It's a perfect way to send him off, and we never need to see him again. Now, the actor already said goodbye, but then he already walked it back and was like, I mean, I've said goodbye before. Once they back up the Brinks truck, because they're desperate, he's going to come back. I really hope they don't, because it was so perfect. But we shall wait and see. For now, if you can,
Don't even watch season one. Season one is just nonsense. Oh, it's Loki, but he's a frog or a fucking alligator. Nonsense. This one, though. Oof. You watch the last episode of that one to set up He Who Remains, and then you watch this, and then that's it. And it's probably the best thing Marvel's ever produced. Probably because Feige had nothing to do with it. You know. That, I give it an awesome. Back to the panel. We'll discuss.
The fact that he snuck in a Tom Cruise connection there, like, only fucking Otto. Yo, bravo to you. Only you. Only you can make pull that. I was like, where the hell is he going with this? I agree 1,000%. Awesome. I was really worried coming out of season one, how would they continue it? And it flowed amazingly. Ouroboros as a character was awesome. Can't say enough about Mr. Owen Wilson playing Morbius. I think this is the best character I've ever seen him play. And he was still himself, which is crazy to say that he hadn't, it was still him, like the wow guy. And he played it so perfectly. I love how he snuck in the backstory with the jet ski. We all wanted closure on that. And we got a little bit, we got that in season two. Sylvie built off what she had before. Granted, we didn't see enough. I don't think we saw enough of her. But when we saw her, it was impactful. It meant something, like she was there with a purpose. Miss Minutes was probably the scariest villain we've never seen fully become a villain ever. I really wanted them to dive into that AI, kind of tap into that. Maybe she finds an old Ultron skin somewhere lying in time. Amazing there. And then I can't give Jonathan Majors enough credit for playing a different version of He Who Remains so perfectly. I think Victor Timely was like that loss. I don't know who I am. I may be turning into a villain, but it's with a good reason kind of backstory. And then Tom Hiddleston, like he, this has been the best character development I've ever seen for a character. To see where he was when he first came into the MCU as that hated villain. And the more times he died, the more we fell in love with him throughout his progress in the MCU. And you said it, Otto, the score, like the music in this season, like after every end credit, you just stood there listening to like, I know you don't have mid-credit scenes, but I'm going to watch because I need to hear this score. Like, turn your volume up, walk away, and just absorb everything that happened in the previous episode. For me, absolutely awesome from start to finish. I love the fact that the same team behind season two of Loki will be doing Daredevil. They're the creative team behind it. So I'm hella looking forward to that. For me, from top to bottom, I think Loki season two and the way it ended was probably the, like, I told my friend that this is might be the crown jewel of the MCU, that when they go back and show actors what you can be, they're showing them season two, episode six of Loki. So for me, end to end, season two was awesome.
Disney Plus has been hit or miss, off and on, up and down, good and bad. And usually what happens is because of the formula that they use, the six episodes, the fifth episode being all of the backstory and drama and emotion, and then the sixth episode being just a CGI fight. And, you know, the reason we don't really break down episode per episode is because I like to see if they can stick the landing, if they can, you know, close it out well. And a lot of times that sixth episode is the one that lowers my grade for the Disney Plus MCU show specifically. And I've stood on this show and I've said that to me, Loki season one was the best show that they put on their MCU Disney Plus. But now Loki season two is now the best MCU Disney Plus show that they've put on there. And it surpassed it in every way. It brought it in and became Loki's story. Instead of a Loki variant story, it became this Loki that we were following. It's his story, and it gave us closure on Loki as a whole. This was his endgame Tony Stark moment. You know, even concluding it with the line that he said to his father in the first Thor movie and coming full circle, titling it Glorious Purpose, which was the name of the first episode and the last episode, full circle, you know, him wanting a throne, but then not wanting a throne, but not really deserving a throne, but then now being, you know, selfless instead of selfish, you know, and everything his father was trying to teach him and stuff. So, you know, Odin's sons both became worthy. They both became, you know, worthy to be selfless and care for others. And I just thought it was, I had no idea where it was going. And I was nervous after, you know, the previous episodes where it was like, okay, everything went blank. Where do we go? We knew episode 5 was going to be backstory, but we got the depth and backstory of each character became Loki's friends. And we got, that's what gave his purpose, saving his friends, you know, sacrificing himself for others. And I thought that those two episodes really brought it all home. Him almost thinking, oh, he might kill Sylvie. Like, I gotta kill her. That's the sacrifice I gotta make. I gotta kill me. But then it was like, no, the sacrifice is I gotta me myself sacrifice to also let her live. So I thought that was well played. I thought it was emotional. I thought it was a great ending for Loki's story arc. You know, 14, 15 years. He was one of the, you know, highly loved characters, and then he got what I guess they wanted to do for Black Widow, what they wanted to do to some others, but he got it. He got the type of ending that Tony Stark also got. Brilliant, awesome, all the way around. The new best MCU Disney Plus show, in my opinion. Awesome.
Ah, straight A's.
We all loved it. Look, Otto, look at you. You gave it an awesome. You gave it an awesome.
Tom Cruise, baby, Tom Cruise. You know, it is what it is.
I just want you to realize that, you know, the MCU cannot be dead when they make something like this.
But it is, because this is over. You know what I'm saying? That's what makes it count. That this was a true ending.
But like you said,
Feige can't fuck it up. I mean, he's going to try to fuck it up.
Those shows will also be doing Daredevil. And
yeah, but they also made half of Daredevil already, and they had to reset the whole thing because they fucked it up because Feige's trash. So I don't know. I'm just grateful that we got a good piece of content.
We did.
I've invested all this time in this fucking MCU, same as you, gentlemen. And obviously, I've soured on it a long time ago, but I'm still hanging in there trying to see because I like these characters. I want to see them work. So when they finally do it right, I'm like, fucking yes, let's go. But leave it alone. Don't fuck it up. Leave it alone. That ending was flawless. Don't bring him back. I know you're desperate. Oh, let's bring back a fucking Iron Man. Let's bring back fucking... Leave him alone. Look, my voice. Leave him alone, please.
I agree with you there, though. He needs, like, this is putting the bow on it, like wrapping it up. Like, you put this on your mantle and you let others admire it for years to come and say, yeah, look, I did that. This was awesome. This was great. Will never be done like this again, and he will never ever play this role again. Because it was a fitting ending, like you said. You know, we didn't get to see, you know, Scarlett Johansson have her ending. You know, Chadwick Boseman's not getting his ending. You know, like Tony's ending was jumbled in everyone else's ending. You know, this is what it was. It was, you know, Captain America's ending, Tony's ending. Like it was the original stepping away. Shoot, even Hawkeye got a semi-ending in his own little series, you can say. But for Loki, for like the number one villain we've ever seen at MCU, to have his chance to walk away, priceless. You can't. I don't think it can be done any better than what it was done.
Exactly. And it was unexpected. Like when they first announced the show, we didn't know where they were going, and then we saw season one, and we're like, okay, this is a fun show. And then season two is like, okay, this is what he needed. This was Loki's send-off. This was, you know, he went on a separate course. He was a variant, but he's that character still. And the emotion is connected to it because he actually saw the whole timeline. So he knows what he went through on the sacred timeline. And then he made some friends on this out of time, you know, space. And did it for centuries. He actually lived a whole nother life, you know, doing this. So now he's a science genius
He's you know, a mathematician, like, you know, he knows all this stuff, and then he lived a whole life, you know, in out of time and repeating the same day over and over again, but still, you know, made a selfless act for some people that he grew to love, because again, he spent centuries with them. He spent centuries with these people, like, you know, and they became his best friends. So I thought it worked so well, and then it was great closure for Tom Hiddleston's Loki. And I agree with both of you guys. I believe we will see him again. I think it just needs to be, because again, he's holding on to every timeline. He can't let go, or spaghetti. So if we just see him, and maybe if Thor just sees him or something, it needs to just be a look and a brother, and that's it, because he can't let go. Hey, let me get a hold these timelines together. So I don't know where they can, you know, go from there. Bless you. But I think we may see him again. Like you said, we're gonna see RDJ at some point again. We're gonna see, you know, Chris is all over again, because multiverse, it's gonna happen. We know it's gonna happen. But Loki, you know, you gotta leave it alone. You gotta leave him alone. So, but it was a great show. I did not know where it was going. Week to week, I was just like, yo, what are they doing? Are they gonna stick the landing? I'm nervous.
Right. I was worried. I was like, all right, well, they're setting up some shit that they can't really take back. Like, okay, right. Now he can control time. Okay, bro. Now he lives centuries. Okay, bro. Like, he's gonna be too overpowered. What are they gonna do? And they just took him out of it. They just let him have his ending, and they removed him. I was like, holy shit. I thought, since nobody watches Disney Plus shows, they were just gonna like reset the status quo, because they don't really mention anything in the movies or whatever. It's like very loosely, like even like the Marvels. If you didn't watch fucking the Miss Marvel show, they give you a little recap in the beginning, and then that's it. And for Photon, they played a couple scenes from WandaVision. That's it. Mm-hmm. So I was like, all right, this is probably gonna be inconsequential, but it wasn't. I mean, I hope it wasn't, because it was so fucking beautiful and so well done. But just leave it alone, bro. Just leave it alone. Just leave it alone.
And I love the fact that this actually sets up the multiversal war now, because He Who Remains basically set up the Loom to just kill off other branches so he wins again. But now that Loki is keeping every timeline alive, this is how a bunch of his variants can exist, and this is how it changes the trajectory of, you know, we get to those other movies that we know coming, the Kang Dynasty and the Secret Wars. This kind of, you know, sets credence to, oh, this is why it's different from any other timeline, or this is why it's different from He Who Remains winning the war and becoming He Who Remains. This is what changes it, because Loki's keeping multiple timelines alive, and this is kind of what gives that ability to do so. So I feel like this is, you know, like if we all seen The Matrix, you know, in the Matrix, they said, oh, this was the seventh time they went around. The difference this time was, you know, Neo chose love and Trinity. So there was something that changed the path, even though we found out he still was under the blueprint. But now we see the difference in this loop of time is Loki keeping the timelines alive, or so this could lead to that. I feel this is what changes the trajectory of He Who Remains or Kang's plan going forward. So,
well, we gotta see now, because we'll see. You know, that little Deadpool multiverse movies coming next year. So we gotta see what's gonna be after that. And I really hope we do not see Loki in that. But let's see.
And I think we'll see. Like I said, because the Deadpool, the rumor is that the TVA is gonna be in that. So now we kind of see that the TVA are now like Kang police. They're kind of watching Kang more than just going around pruning timelines. Timelines all exist, but they're kind of keeping things from getting out of control. So now the TVA has more of a focus. Excuse me, they have more of a focus. So if they do play a part in Deadpool, it could be because he was hopping around screwing up timelines over there in Fox. And then now we know Photon, or whatever her call sign may become, is on that universe. She got to come back over here. So now things can get a little screwy, so we can see, you know, where that goes. So now the TVA, again, we were nervous with Disney Plus shows, because we were like, well, do they matter to the movies? And so far we've seen most of them
payoff to the movie side. I think the only ones that have, you know, Hawkeye now has been introduced into the movie side of things. You know, we just haven't seen, obviously, She-Hulk, Deadpool yet. I mean, not Daredevil yet. But for the most part, the characters from the shows have been introduced and then now brought into the movies. So, you know, the TVA can now be introduced into the movie in some way, shape, or form. So now that, you know, and now we know what their role is. But again, like you said, they'll probably get a little recap in whatever movie they do pop up in, if it's Owen Wilson or just some random, you know.
I think it was supposed to be Miss Minutes, but they might have just changed everything. So who knows?
Well, she's been rebooted, so she could, again, they may reprogram her to be more under control. Because relax, you know, you out here talking about, if you gave me a body. if I had a body or something, we could play more than chess. Listen, AI, hot pants, like, calm yourself. Like, so, if you know, so now that she's been rebooted, they could, listen, track Kangs and slow down. Like, what's going on in the multiverse? You know what I'm saying? So that kind of gives them a reset. You know, I think the show set them up to appear in the movies now. So
I have a question. Obviously, the elephant in the room, the Kang dynasty of it all, the man behind Kang. Do you want to see him recast? I know it's his case is still fluctuating and blah, 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 but do you think they should just move forward with The Rock like you were suggesting?
That was not my suggestion. That was purely your suggestion. I don't want The Rock nowhere near the MCU because he
ruined the franchises. It's inevitable.
I don't want to see it. However, we don't know what their plan was with Kang or where we would have seen Jonathan Majors next. So he may not need to be in Deadpool. It's the only movie coming out next year. Hopefully if the case, but obviously they filmed beforehand, but if hopefully they can settle this case prior to the next movie that's come out in 2025, we can move on. If he's innocent, if he's guilty and they prove that he's guilty, then you gotta do the time. So, I mean, again, I guess that's the gift and the curse of the strike that gave them some time to hold off on moving forward with movies. And maybe they can see how this case is going before they make a decision. But now, I mean, if they recast Kang or, you know, we don't know where he was going to appear next. And like I said, I feel they're going to introduce Iron Lad at some point, too, so they can have a younger person play him at that point to play a younger Kang, you know, on Nathaniel Richards, for those that know. So that will probably appear in either the Iron Heart show or wherever else. Kamala Khan's going to pop up next to recruit her team. So again, I think they have some time.
Ironheart is another one of those females, right, that they brought in for these Young Avengers that are exclusively women for some reason.
Again, Iron Lad. We'll see if that happens. I feel Iron Lad will be in that show.
As a woman?
No, as a man. I believe they're going to have Nathaniel Richards, you know, not Natalie. I think there will be Nathaniel Richards in that show.
Okay.
So I can see that. Giving them some, so I think they have some time before they, again, I don't know what their plan was for the next movie he was supposed to appear in, but I, you know, as thus far Disney has been holding off and trying to see where it goes, so I respect them for that much because he was dropped from everything else, you know, instantly. So at least but again, it might not be because they want to give him a chance or innocent to forgive this, because we got a lot of we tied up into him monetarily. So let's just wait it out, you know what I'm saying? So, you know, obviously I don't think they care about him. I think they just, you know, already had some things set in motion and might have cut him a couple of checks already that they have to let him perform some things. So we'll see. You know, the trial starts the end of this month. And it's obviously it's a bunch of misdemeanors, but his character, his literal character, not the character he plays in movies, but his character, his profile is at stake. Nobody's going to want to have a movie starring, you know, a domestic abuser, you know what I'm saying? So even if it's just misdemeanors, it's going to be a bad look for, you know, starring Jonathan Majors. Oh, that guy, he beats his girlfriend. So, or, you know, in a perfect world, not guilty. He's innocent. All right, let's rock and roll. He's Kang in five more movies. Like, we'll see. We'll see.
But then if they do that, then it's like, oh, that's the guy that lost to Ant-Man.
No. That was one variant.
That was a variant that lost it. That was
one variant. I know, but it's still not, you know, it's not a good look.
Well, that's the thing. I mean, with Kang has always been the Brooklyn Brawler of Marvel Comics. You know, he loses
and he loses through multiple.
Gentlemen, games. Please, everyone on this panel knows. We know, but I'm talking about average Johnny Susie.
The average understands that Kang variants lose, which is why there's a he remains. One has to prevail. But at this time, we're going to have...
I'm just saying, if you get somebody in there to play Kang who doesn't lose as per his contract...
That's not going to work.
If you know what I'm talking about. Kang win. A certain great one that'll never lose.
Character lost to even the Young Avengers.
I know you smell what I'm cooking, Paul.
I don't smell it. No, I do not want The Rock anywhere near the MCU. Thank you very much.
You keep bringing him up. That's all I'm saying.
No, you did. And no, don't know.
It's either going to work. Or we pivot to Doctor Doom.
And I think that was part of the plan anyway, which is why I think Kang Dynasty came before Secret Wars. I think Secret Wars would have been the pivot anyway. They might have to pivot a little sooner. So that could be another shake-up. Oh, Kang Dynasty's pushed up to a Disney Plus show.
Fantastic Four is supposed to come out at some point.
So right? The rumor is they're revealing the cast sometime soon as well. So that's another movie that got pushed back. That was going to be the first movie of Phase 6, which was supposed to start in 2025, but now it's going to be...
So based on the trajectory, we're assuming it's going to be... All four female Fantastic Four members, right? That's what we're doing.
No, we're not assuming that at all. No, we're assuming that it'll be Sue as the only female in the group, and it'll be three men alongside of her. And speaking of, we saw the Marvels, another possible them. They said the astronaut dude said they sent a team out to find out what was going on. I think is that the team? Did they send out four people? You know, I wonder if it was them. Like,
I think they sent cats. They sent cats with people inside them. By the way, are those cats just going to be on Earth now? Or like,
they're here. Unless Fury took them back up. You know.
Black girl magic.
But back to Loki. I'm glad that we all agree that it was awesome. Otto, would you say best MCU Disney Plus show?
I would say best MCU piece of content for like years, probably. Like, it's way better than Wakanda Forever. I'll give you that much. But I do think it. My number one has always been Wanda, and I do think it edges it out only because this doesn't have any boner jokes. So it just. It's got jet ski jokes, but no boner jokes. But
jet ski jokes are good, you know?
This edges it out for sure. This is the number one.
All right. For sure. So we agree. Marvel's back.
Yeah, so we're clear. Season two in a vacuum. Season one is still number fucking 10.
12 episodes of Loki as a package deal. Marvel's back. You know, they're back on top, baby. Thank you, Kevin Feige.
But hold on. Another thing is we're all enjoying it. We all can agree it's a fine piece of content. Is anybody watching this? Is anybody going to see it? Disney released some numbers. They're like, 11 million people saw it. That's cap. I want to see the official numbers, not from Disney. Is anybody watching this? Is anybody talking about it? I know we are, but does anybody care?
We don't care about anybody else. We're talking about it. Okay. We love it. Marvel's back. Otto said it himself. He's looking forward to the next phase. He's looking forward to that. What's to come? Because he can't wait. This is the
best thing. I can smell what's being cooked.
No.
I know what's coming.
Yeah, no, we're cooking up more multiversal fun. You know what I'm saying? By the way, it's all connected. You know what I'm saying? Or Boris was in there from everything always over there, upside down.
One last thing on the, because, you know, literally this ended with the man holding the fucking multiverse. Are you guys over the multiverse?
Not yet, because I think
I'll be over it once we see the clear connection between the X-Men, Fantastic Four, and everything. When we see that clear bridge and see where the trajectory is going, then I'll be like, all right, move on to something else.
I feel like this is the turning point. I think that's what I said. I think this is the turning point where we've been introduced to it. We keep talking about it. Now something's going to happen with it. I think this is the turning point.
Think about this way. Infinity Saga was what, 14 movies-ish?
Something like
right,
that. Probably more. Mm-hmm.
Probably more. 21, something like that.
Something like that. Yeah.
So, I mean, we have some time to build off it. We just, you know, Endgame was that first introduction. Then you got Spider-Man. You know, No Way Home, and now you got Doctor Strange. Mm-hmm. So, I mean,
yeah, that's what I said. I think
we've been introduced to it. I think everyone gets how it works. And I think now, and that's why I said the post-credit scene for the Marvels, I think is like for the first time someone is now on that other side. Because even in right. Spider-Man, it was teased. Oh, they're coming through. Nope, stop them. Stop them. Now somebody actually crossed over. So now we could get, and again, I don't know what they're going to do with, you know, Captain Rambo, but now she's on the other side of the timeline. So we can, you know, if they follow up on her at some point, I think we're going to get something from that perspective outside of 616 or 199999 or whatever you want to call it, the universe. But I think now we're going to get that. And Deadpool, obviously, is, you know, again, the first movie from the Fox franchise in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. So now, that as I said, I think we're at a turning point now to where the narrative is going to be from the Fox franchises. And, oh, snap, they're coming over here now. And then we're going to get cross-universe activity, you know, saying.
And shout out to Marvel for showing Beast first off the jump.
Like, and looking great in his CGI form, you know.
I think that's the best CGI version of him I've seen, though.
And Kelsey
Grammer's voice. The only thing is I was looking forward to new X-Men, not just the same ones, the same actors playing the same X-Men. I mean, obviously that could still change, but.
And I think it might. I think the introduction is just the multiverse.
Right, to have that familiarity with, hey, right. I know who this is based on voice.
Right, yeah, but yeah. We got Wolverine, the same guy. You got Xavier in the multiverse, same guy. And now Beast, same guy. More than likely, it's the same people. I want to see new people, but all right, maybe there's some time
for that. We know it's fan service. Right. I think that's part of it. It's like
give
the people what they want, and then pivot to, because Feige's been wanting those toys in his sandbox, so he's gonna want to play with those toys first, and then we can go somewhere from there. We might get a reboot. You know what I'm saying? The Secret Wars might end in a whole recast, start over from scratch. You know what I'm saying? Now that everyone's introduced, now I got to play with all my toys and all the DLC. Start it over, new game. You know, that could happen. You know what I'm saying? But I think the fan service was what they felt was wanted, and the multiverse was the best way for them to introduce it. And that's why I said Deadpool now, you know, I think that's going to be, oh, wow, Fox is here now. It's okay, let's go. Like, you know what I'm saying? So I think this is we're going to see. That's why they've been going so hard. Deadpool's coming. The strike is happening, but we already been pre-post production and some stuff. So when we start filming again, we can catch it up. Coming out this summer, promise. Coming out this, you know, because Deadpool. I think they've been trying to get us to that point where, look what we did. We got these guys. We got these toys. We got these new those toys you loved over here. They're coming over here, you know. And I think, and hopefully it's good. You know, obviously that doesn't mean it's going to be great, just because we see the thing that we knew from over there.
Member berries.
Yeah, but they have to make it work. Spider-Man No Way Home worked. It was great to, but it worked. So if they, as long as they can make it work, I'm here for it. And Loki worked. So I feel like Marvel's back. Again, I got to keep saying it because Otto, you know, Marvel's back. Otto agrees.
It's over. It's over, baby. It's over. You guys are done.
So yeah, groggy voice is what he's trying to say. Okay, I've turned this video off too. That
Marvel's back.
Marvel's back. He's loving it. He's looking forward to it. You know, this is he wants to say thank you, Kevin Feige.
Fuck Feige.
Otto loves you, Kevin Feige. He really does. It's tough love, but he loves you. You know, only Kevin Feige can pull this off.
Yeah, okay.
15 years, 45 projects. You know, listen, man. Yes. The Marvels isn't selling as much as people expected. Everyone's a lot of dud. You know, hey, they can't all be home runs. Can't knock them all out the park. But we're looking forward to what's to come. Echo trailer looks good. You know, Deadpool looks promising. You know, I'm here for it. Let's go. Any final thoughts you guys wanted to have before we sign off?
I feel like the audience smells what you're cooking, and they know what's
coming. I'm not cooking anything, actually. we don't have smell of vision yet. The Rock needs to stay far away from the MCU.
Go back to Fast and Furious.
His contract of I can't get hit. I can't get. What's the fun in that? Like, there's no fun in that. Like, come on. We seen Tony Stark die.
Inevitable. Like, it's inevitable.
No. Thanos was inevitable. Look what happened to him. He gone.
They're gonna bring him back too. These fucking bums. They're gonna bring him
too. Well, his brother's coming back. So did you see that they're working on Eternals too? So we'll finally get some answers about that robot in the water.
Yeah, right.
We'll finally get some answers. Hey, anybody notice that? We don't talk about that thing in the water.
The big ass hand.
Yeah, just.
And there was a shot of Earth from space in Marvels, but I guess it was on the other side.
It was on the other side. Yeah.
Mama come this side.
We don't talk about that. But I mean, hey, at some point we will get an answer for that. At some point, I know Otto, you've been looking for what's his name, the actor from Eternals at the post credits.
Yeah, that's right. I need to see him. I need to see him.
So you know you've been dying. When is he coming back? When is he coming?
Mr. Harry Styles.
He's excited. Kevin Feige said that they discussed the return. He's excited. Kevin's excited. All that means is they got something already in the works. They just can't say it yet. But you know how it is. Listen, it's working. All right. The multiverse.
No, it's not.
All of it. Okay. Everything always all at once. The Spider-Man animated, you know, Spider-Verse movies. They're all connected, baby. It's all connected. That Tom
Scorpion movie, King.
It's connected to this too somehow, some way. You know what I'm saying? It's all in the MCU multiverse. It's all connected to this. Because Kevin Feige did that.
Sure.
Listen, man.
Are we done? Can we go now?
Yeah, we can go now. Thank you, guys. Thank you guys for watching. Later, guys. Give us your thoughts and opinions and things in the comments below and all that good stuff. And we'll be back for the next project. Well, we got to catch up on some other movies, too. Sorry for the layover. I'll explain all that stuff later for you. But we will be catching up on some projects. We were nervous with the whole strike thing. We thought we might have had to talk about old movies and stuff. So, you know what I'm saying? But we got a lot of catching up to do. I promise you.
We're back, baby. We're back.
That's right.
Not Marvel, though. Marvel's done.
Oh, Marvel's back. You heard the man. I'm going to cut that up. It'll be the intro right there.
He said it.
I will sue you.
We back. Thanks, Otto. I feel you on that.
We back.
Later, y'all.